Have you ever played a video game where you shoot people? The act of killing another human being is widely regarded as one of the worst things a person can do. So why is it that every time I play through F.E.A.R. Extraction Point, I'm completely entranced by the brutal violence I leave in my wake? Is it because I appreciate the combat skills and slow motion abilities of the Point Man? Perhaps it's because of the striking intelligence of the replicas or the exciting level design. Or maybe it's because there is a dark, primal desire hidden deep within every man that urges them to endlessly unleash all of their wrathful fury out onto the world. It turns out that I just really like aiming and shooting at things on computer screens. Now, when you combine that fact with the crisp graphics of the classic Lithtech engine and the breathtaking slow motion of the Matrix, the game transforms the horrendous act of killing people into something that's not only really entertaining, but also rather beautiful. So anyway, that's what this video is gonna be about. My all-time favorite DLC expansion of any video game, F.E.A.R. Extraction Point. But before I can start off with the plot, I have to get some boring computery stuff out of the way first, so just bear with me on this. Alright, so as soon as you launch the game, you're gonna see a pretty big issue right off the bat, which is the resolution. Back when F.E.A.R. was first released, computer monitors were usually a lot smaller than they are now, so the game defaults to a very tiny display size. Now, typically you would just go into the settings to fix this, but the available game resolutions don't go up to the modern standard of 1080p. Fortunately for players who bought the Platinum Collection, there should be a configuration file in the game directory that you can use to just type in the resolution that you want. Alright, now that we got that working, there's one more thing I'd like to mention, which is VSync. Now, for most other games, I'd recommend having VSync off because of the lag it usually causes, but for F.E.A.R., I get some noticeable screen tear when I activate slow motion, and the only way to fix it is to turn VSync back on. I don't know, maybe it needs more gigabytes or something. Now, as for the other settings, I'd recommend using the in-game performance test to see which ones work best for your system. Okay, that's it for the boring crap. Now, let's begin with the plot.
Wait, dumbass, hang on a second, you're not finished yet. Okay guys, I'm coming back to this part of the video 8 months later because my stupid past self forgot to mention the FPS issues that really start to ramp up around interval 3. If you actually want to play Extraction Point with no visual hiccups, you need to download the Direct Input FPS fix and put it in the folder that contains Extraction Point's executable. Now be mindful when you do this because not only is the DLC called F.E.A.R. XP for some reason, but putting it in the Platinum Collection folder will not work. You have to put it in the F.E.A.R. XP directory specifically. Okay, I think that's everything. Now we can begin with the plot.
F.E.A.R. Extraction Point is a direct sequel to the first F.E.A.R. game. The shit literally takes place like 30 seconds after the first game ends, which just adds on to the sense that the Point Man really can't catch a fucking break. And that's who our protagonist is yet again, the ever-silent Point Man, a first encounter assault recon operative with reflexes so quick that he can enter a state of being where the world appears to slow down around him. Well, sort of, at least. It's not just his reflexes that give him slow motion powers. See, back in F.E.A.R. 1, there was a company called Armacam that was well known for producing cutting-edge technology for various militaries across the world. So naturally, like any other video game corporation worth its stock market value, instead of just maintaining their position as a successful business conglomerate, they decided to fuck it all up and do some off-the-wall scientific bullshit that ended up getting thousands of people killed. The geniuses over at the R&D department came up with the brilliant idea to start conducting inhumane experiments on young girls to see if any of them had psychic powers. And they eventually found one who did when a senior researcher named Harlan Wade volunteered his own 8-year-old daughter, Alma Wade, for testing and analysis. Their plan was to have her bear children who would also have ESP and make them into telepathic commanders for the newly developed replica soldiers, a genetically engineered clone army that Armacam also happened to be working on around this time. Alma gave birth to 2 sons, and since Armacam had no use for her after that point, they killed her and sealed her body in an underground vault so she could never escape. Seemingly undeterred by this, Alma's vengeful spirit waited a few years and then took control of one of her sons named Paxton Fettle and influenced him to use his replica army to free her body from the underground facility, and that's basically the plot of Fear 1. So now, in Fear Extraction Point, Alma is loose and wreaking havoc on the world. And since there's basically no stopping her at this point, your only mission right now is to survive. Oh, and there's just one more thing I forgot to mention. The Point Man is Alma's other son. Our journey begins with the Point Man and his buddies having crash-landed into a nondescript Philadelphian apartment building. Accompanying us on our mission are the Delta Force operator Sergeant Douglas Holliday and F.E.A.R. Technical Officer Jin Sun Kwan. But because they somehow ended up on a different floor than us, the Point Man is going to be on his own for the time being. Anyway, the whole city has been entirely abandoned because of a big-ass explosion that happened at the end of Fear 1, and the remaining characters are just trying to regroup so that they can get out of there. Speaking of characters, now's probably a good time to introduce them a little more. Not only does the Point Man have one of the best names for a self-insert character that I've ever heard, he is also a super karate martial arts master ninja assassin. He can slide, punch, lean like a boxer, and he has this insane scissor kick thing that he does whenever you melee and jump forward simultaneously. Not to mention that any hit from him will send enemies flying like they just got hit by a truck. You can get pretty creative with the Point Man's hand-to-hand combat skills, and I haven't even started yet on how bonkers he is when he's got a gun in his hands. Now, as for the other two characters, well, they're pretty simple. Sergeant Holliday is your standard tough military bro who actually shares the same voice actor as Sergeant Johnson from Halo and basically every other character trait of his. Jin is a technical officer slash combat medic who doesn't seem to have any actual weapons training, and it's implied that she is one of the very few people who has seen the Point Man without his mask.
What do you think of the new Point Man?
Well, he's pretty cute.
Boy, I sure hope she's not talking about the Fear 3 Point Man, because that bitch looks like he just got thawed out of a fucking glacier. Now, obviously, these characters aren't as layered or dynamic as they could be, but I think the groundwork here is solid, and they get the job done. And besides, these two aren't the main focus of the game. He is.
Dead.
It is my opinion that the replica soldiers are the greatest video game enemies ever created. Now, I've played a lot of games, you know, I'm a true gamer, and I can confidently say that even today, 18 years after the first F.E.A.R. game's release, they are unmatched in their intelligence, design, and lore. I mean, where do I even begin with these guys? There's a fucking MIT research paper that's been written about them and countless videos on YouTube analyzing their groundbreaking behavior. The AI for all the enemies in F.E.A.R. is tremendous, but come on, nobody's making 10-minute videos about the ATC security guards or the Nightcrawlers. It's the replicas that are the stars of the show here, and I think what makes them the most memorable faction is their multitude of flawlessly spoken and perfectly implemented voice lines. For example, whenever you're in combat and you take cover or crouch behind something, there's a good chance a replica will call out the exact thing the point man is hiding behind.
Where is he? Behind those boxes! Behind the crate! Behind the machine! Behind the pillar! In the duct! On the catwalk! Behind the wall! Behind the pipe! Behind the table!
All of these very specific voice lines make the replicas seem much livelier and more dynamic than other video game enemies who just say some basic shit like, "He's over there, guys," because it limits the odds that they'll repeat the same phrase over and over again. It's stuff like this that makes it really easy to forget that the replicas don't actually have eyes or ears or even brains. They're just sets of ones and zeros, but they have so many great design tricks up their sleeves, I just think of them as little soldier guys running around on my computer screen. They're almost always saying something, and even when they're not, it's usually during a situation where it makes sense not to talk, like when they're the last one alive in a squad and they're trying to remain hidden. They're also very loud and expressive when they speak, so you likely won't have a hard time understanding what they're saying or what emotions they're feeling. I could literally talk about just their voices for like 30 minutes straight, but if I want to finish this video before I die of old age, I gotta move on. Now, of course, no, the replicas don't have perfect AI, as some people will be obnoxiously happy to tell you, but the fact that they're still running circles around today's video game enemies 18 years later says everything you need to know about them. I mean, for God's sake, they were made during a time when computers looked like this, and I'd say they're about 2 code lines away from becoming self-aware. Alright, so I was gonna do a joke here about how they're obviously not self-aware, and I was gonna sneak up on one of them and have him say something stupid, but I tried like 20 times to do it and they noticed me every single time. I'm not kidding, I swear, I was using noclip and the special ghost mode command that's supposed to turn you invisible, but they just kept fucking shooting me anyway. Honestly though, I can't come up with a better way to exemplify that these guys will always figure out some way to surprise you, so I'm just gonna leave it at that. But since the topic of their AI has already been covered pretty extensively at this point, I'd now like to discuss what I think is the most underappreciated aspect of the replicas, their simple but effective lore. Most people seem to just write them off as generic clone troopers, which is a real shame if you ask me, because whenever I think about them, a million questions enter my head. For example, how old are they? Are they all the same age? We know the reason they exist is because the American government lost the Vietnam War and they asked Armacam to develop an army of soldiers that could be controlled by a psychic leader, since they felt that communication between commanders and soldiers was too slow during combat. So in response, Armacam created Project Origin, but it's unclear when exactly they did this. I mean, if they made the replicas right after Vietnam, wouldn't they all be like 50 years old since the game takes place in 2025? Probably not, so we're left to assume Armacam created them a decade or maybe two after the Vietnam War ended. On a more philosophical note, do replicas have souls? They are humans after all, even though they were grown in a lab somewhere and not really born from a woman. Do they actually enjoy inflicting pain on others, or are they made to? We see that they have no qualms about killing innocent civilians, but is this because they're evil by nature or because they are forced to be by outside influences? Is it possible for them them to be reformed so that they can be beneficial members of society, or is their insatiable bloodlust just hard-coded into their brains? Speaking of their brains, is the link to Paxton Fettel purely psychic, or is there a technology component to it, like a microchip or something? If that's the case, to what extent are they cybernetically enhanced? Why are the replica heavies so massive compared not only to their regular brethren, but to humans in general? Did Armacam use some kind of experimental growth hormone to make them abnormally tall and strong? Maybe that's the reason why they can't speak and instead only make monstrous grunting and gurgling noises. On the other hand, the replica assassins don't make any noise whatsoever, not even when they get shot or killed. We see in-game that they have immense physical strength. As a matter of fact, they're so strong that they don't even use weapons of any kind and instead opt to simply beat the ever-living piss out of their unsuspecting enemies. So why are they so different from the standard replicas if they're all clones of the same DNA? Well, the assassins were the product of a 1973 Armacam research initiative called Project Icarus, which was created when NASA was in need of a way for their astronauts to maintain bone density when they were in microgravity. So after some good old-fashioned unethical experimentation, Armacam developed a carbon fiber composite that they thought could fix the problem. In the name of science and money, the company decided to perform surgery on a few of their newly developed replicas and replace every single bone in their bodies with this composite to see if it worked. As a result of the operation, not only did these replicas maintain the entirety of their bone density, but the carbon fiber also made them exceedingly nimble without making them lose any muscle mass. Is this experimental procedure the reason why they don't speak, or were they just trained to never make any noise? And why are there only three digits on their gloves? Do they actually only have three fingers, or are they just doing that Star Trek turbo nerd hand sign? The replicas are a masterclass in visual storytelling and sound design, and their lore does a perfect job of answering some questions, but also leaving just the right amount to the player's imagination. The last thing I want to mention about the replicas before I move on is that, canonically speaking, they're actually one of the strongest factions in the entire game, if not the strongest. It seems to be a commonly overlooked fact that at the end of Fear 1, they basically win. They make it to the vault before the Point Man does, and it's clear that they would have set Alma free themselves if Harlan Wade didn't get there first. Now, to me, this is just even more reason to respect them, but this is also where I start getting into spoilers, so I'm gonna have to end this little section right here. So in conclusion, the replicas are the perfect enemies for this game, and I'm very happy to say that we're gonna be spending a whole lot of time with them. After we get out of the tutorial area and meet our two companions, the player is guided towards this foreboding but also very pretty looking church. Now, you may be wondering why the replicas are just standing still with their heads down and not currently trying to kill me.
He's just standing there.
Well, the reason for this is because their psychic link to Paxton Fettel has been severed since the Point Man shot him in the face at the end of Fear 1. Without the link to Fettel, the replicas just kind of turn off since they're not receiving any orders on what to do. They're not dead or anything, you can still see them breathing and swaying in the wind, but they're basically asleep on their feet. Fortunately for us, this doesn't last very long at all, since the moment we walk into the church, Paxton Fettel shows up alive and well, eager to sick his loyal soldiers on us once again. And just like that, we get right back into the swing of things. this first fight is absolutely tremendous, and it's a great introduction to F.E.A.R.'s impeccable combat. Now, of course, the game doesn't just throw an entire squad of replicas at you all at once. Instead, they wake up in short intervals as Fettel re-establishes his psychic link with each one. In addition, these are recon replicas, the weakest variant armed only with MP5s and grenades, so it's definitely a very manageable opening battle. Once all is said and done and the room is cleared of hostiles, Alma makes her return and lets us know that she's going to be much more involved this time around. She tears up the floor right underneath the Point Man's boots, revealing a secret labyrinth hidden below the church. Wasting no time and asking no questions, the Point Man leaps into the crypt and continues on his way. You may have noticed earlier in the faction ranking thing I made that Alma has a question mark next to her name. Now, the reason I did this is because it's unclear to me where exactly her allegiance lies at times. Sometimes she helps the Point Man by opening a path for him, other times she's throwing him out of windows or summoning living nightmares that want to murder him. I'm pretty sure she's the one who revived Fettel too, but I'll talk about that more later. I also forgot to mention earlier what difficulty I'm playing on, so I'm gonna explain that real quick before we continue. In F.E.A.R., the difficulty setting has no effect on how the enemy AI behaves. Instead, it only changes their stats and how much damage they deal. I've heard that on higher difficulties, replicas use less voice lines, so it's harder to tell what they're doing, but I'm not sure if that's true or not. Regardless, there are several different difficulties to choose from. Low, moderate, high, extreme, and a secret fifth difficulty called Fuck You Bitch Die Now difficulty that can be unlocked by unbinding the slow motion key. Now, Extraction Point probably isn't gonna be a horribly challenging game no matter what difficulty you play on, mostly because healing is instantaneous and bullet time is pretty overpowered. Don't get me wrong, I absolutely love the slow motion and I would never want to live in a world where it wasn't put in the game, but I feel as though it's a little too easy to abuse it sometimes. And as for the healing, I don't know, maybe a 1 or 2 second animation where the Point Man uses a syringe would make things a little more balanced. It's kind of ridiculous that if you have enough medkits, you can basically become invincible by just spamming the heal button while you're taking damage. But anyway, this game is at its best when you're on an even playing field with the AI, so I'm gonna use extreme difficulty for this video, and I recommend you do too. Moving on, we pick back up with the Point Man exploring the crypt below the church. And you know, I gotta say, this is such a perfect setting for a F.E.A.R. level. One of my biggest issues with the first game was that there were only really 4 different environments: offices, warehouses, labs, and the occasional crack house. Now, of course, the gunfights in F.E.A.R. 1 were refreshing and exhilarating every single time, but the backdrops for those fights did start to feel stale after a little while. Thankfully, Extraction Point does not have this problem whatsoever, and this will only become more evident as we continue. We're still gonna see offices and warehouses on our journey, but they're much less frequent and the other environments are very diverse and atmospheric. As we explore the eerie catacombs, we eventually come across a new weapon, the glorious VK-12 combat shotgun. What you're looking at right now is the most dependable weapon in any video game ever. This thing's always got your back. It doesn't jam, it doesn't whiff, and if you actually run out of ammo with it, I'd have to assume you were setting out to do so on purpose. If you want to make it through the horrors of Extraction Point, then the VK-12 is your best friend. Soon after our introduction to this magnificent firearm, the Point Man witnesses something rather strange.
What the hell? Let's secure this area. Yes, sir.
So in the next room, we see a replica check his squadmate's pulse by
touching the ground next to him for like half a second and then concluding that he is indeed dead. It seems that Alma's release has caused violent apparitions to invade the world of the living, and we see here that they're capable of killing humans with ease. On top of that, there's replicas all over these catacombs, and after a couple more battles with the recon soldiers, we meet a new variant. Tactical replicas. Tactical units have a bit more health and armor than recon replicas, and they typically wield shotguns when they're in combat. Also, have you ever wondered what would happen if a replica stubbed his toe? So anyway, once we take care of these last couple squads, we've nearly made it out of the crypt. I think it was a pretty fun area, but there's one last thing I gotta mention before we move on. Now, as I'm sure you're already aware, F.E.A.R. is not only an action FPS game. It's a psychological horror with spooky little girls and reanimated corpses and, you know, shit like that. And for the most part, that's all it really is, especially in F.E.A.R. 1, where some of the horror is so dated it's straight up corny. But sometimes, as you're playing through the game, the point man makes a wrong turn, and he goes somewhere he really doesn't belong. Sometimes, you get a feeling that's a bit more unsettling than ghostly little kids and jump scares. Sometimes, you find yourself in a place where no living thing should ever be. And whenever that happens, you are no longer in the world as we know it, because you have been taken to the Almaverse.
It's a pretty interesting place. Alma Wade's fascinating character serves as the beating heart of F.E.A.R.'s story. She has had a direct influence on almost every single major event or person in the game, and at this point she's essentially a full-blown god, able to do basically whatever the hell she wants. Most of the time, she rightfully uses her powers to get back at the people who made her life a living hell in the first place, but whenever she's not, one of her favorite pastimes is to abduct her estranged son into her own personal nightmare dimension and use his mind as a fucking playground. To be fair, however, this type of behavior is entirely within her character, since not only is she batshit insane, but I'd say she's had a bit of a rough upbringing, to say the least, so she's got plenty of reason to hate all of humanity. I mean, me personally, I haven't been through half of the shit that she's had to put up with, and I still want to. But what makes Alma interesting as a villain is that even despite her suffering, she actually doesn't seem to hate all of humanity. Even though she's tried to kill him a bunch of times, in her own little unhinged way, Alma does seem to actually care about the Point Man and recognizes that he is her son. Later in the game, there's even a part where she straight up saves his life, and it's not incidental or anything like that, she does it out of genuine concern for his well-being. She does a great job of keeping the player on their toes because you never really know what her goals are, and I like that because not only does it fit her character, it also makes her a little bit more layered and sympathetic. Personally, I still think the decision to make the Point Man Alma's son was just a weird-ass thing to do, but I won't deny that it makes for a pretty unique dynamic between a protagonist and antagonist. Now, where does the Almaverse fit into all this? Well, in terms of narrative, it's the main method used by the game to communicate Alma's backstory to the player. As I understand it, it's basically some type of parallel reality created by Alma's pain or something, and it's separate from the other horror elements in F.E.A.R. because it only exists within the Point Man's mind. Now, of course, anybody who's played F.E.A.R. knows that the Almaverse isn't quite as intense as I made it out to be in my little animation, but I thought I would give it a more bombastic interpretation to spice up the video a bit. Actually, in my honest opinion, the Almaverse in the first game is, well, kinda lame. There's no variation in it whatsoever. Every single scene just depicts something related to Alma's experiences at the clinic where her kids were born, and that's it. It would have been cool to see something like Alma's first time discovering her psychokinesis, or maybe some experiments that Armacam ran on her, but no, you're just stuck in this rat trap hospital shithole the whole time. Luckily for us, however, by the time Extraction Point takes place, the Point Man and the player already know who Alma is, so the Almaverse is no longer limited to just one boring building. Our first trip into the Abyss comes right after our final fight with the replicas in the catacombs. As you can see, once we step inside, we are shown a clear depiction of... Well, actually, I have no earthly idea what the hell I'm looking at right now, and that's just the way I like it. I'm of the opinion that not every scene in the Almaverse has to have a narrative. As long as it's creepy or trippy enough, it's gonna entertain me, and that's all I really want from a video game. I've always preferred my horror to be of the unknowable eldritch variety, too, so to that end, I think both Alma and her namesake Dimension do their jobs very well, and I'm looking forward to seeing what else lies ahead. Well, everybody, that's basically it for the first interval of Extraction Point. There's only one more little section after this one, and then we'll finally be out of the church. I wonder what it's gonna be. Another horror sequence? Maybe a puzzle section of sorts? Perhaps some character development between our three heroes? Or is it one of the best gunfights in video game history?
The amount of fun you can have in this tiny little area is honestly pretty mind-boggling. When I first played Extraction Point about a year ago, I distinctly remember rolling my eyes when I opened this door and saw yet another office area since I had just played F.E.A.R. 1 and I was getting pretty tired of the setting. But when I actually played through it, I was astonished at how dynamic each gunfight was, and it was so good I ended up loading the save file a few times after I beat them all just to experience it all over again. Here, let's examine some gameplay to help me prove my point. As you can see, the clip begins with me using slow motion and the Spas 12 to easily kill two replicas. Staying in reflex mode, I move over to the next room and blast this guy, knocking the wind out of him and exposing him for another hit, but then I notice this guy coming right at me. Since the first guy is temporarily indisposed on account of the 7 broken ribs he just got, slow motion in tandem with the trusty shotgun allows me to switch targets and kill this dude before he can kill me. With him dead, I can switch back to the first guy and finish him off with a booty shot. Now I'm all out of slow motion, but there's still a few more replicas to take care of. When I move back outside after taking cover momentarily, this first guy actually gets a couple shots in because I didn't realize I was out of ammo, but when he pushes up too far, I'm able to blast him and use a medkit to heal. At this point, I can hear that there's at least 2 replicas in the next room, and one of them is poking at me with his MP5. Now, because he has superior range, I need to get closer, so I decide to simply grow a pair and kick on slow motion to close the gap, even though it hasn't fully recharged yet. I'm able to use it to kill him, and when I look to the left, I see the other replica I heard earlier. With the two of them dead and me entirely out of slow motion, I move into the next hallway and am surprised by yet another replica. Luckily though, my trusty shotgun comes in handy, and I kill him with only one pull of the trigger. Now I know at this point I'm definitely almost dead, so I get ready to use a medkit, and just as I'm about to do so, bang! That motherfucker at the end of the hallway was camping and he got my ass before I could hit the heal button on my keyboard. But wasn't that great though? See, there's never any frustration in this game whenever you die because it truly feels like the replicas and the point man are on an even playing field. The difficulty comes not from them having a ton of health or any other stupid gimmick, but rather from the way they use their numbers to their advantage and their positioning in the environment. And when you do actually die, there's no bullshit like running back to the boss room or relaunching the level to use a different gun, you just load the save and try again. Now of course, I could have shown a fight where a replica does some awesome bullshit and kills me in an epic duel or something, but I wanted to show a more common example of what an average death in F.E.A.R. really looks like, which typically consists of the replicas methodically whittling down the player's health until one of them finally gets that one last shot in. What amazes me most about this particular section though is that the only replicas here are the basic foot soldiers armed with plain old RPL submachine guns, but even still, they are totally in their element, constantly flanking the point man, knocking cover over, hurling grenades, and of course, talking mad shit. Oh, and by the way, if you've watched the video up to this point and are wondering why I'm playing with the user interface disabled, now's probably a good time to tell you. Basically, there's 2 reasons. One, I like to play without a HUD because it's much more viewer friendly, and 2, for this game, you really don't need it. There's so much visual and audio feedback when you shoot something in this game, hit markers would be completely redundant, and I never really found the lack of a reticle to be that big of a deal because a lot of the combat is very close ranged anyway. Now on the flip side, if you're wondering whether or not you're the one getting shot, the game's got you covered there too, since if you listen closely, you'll be able to hear the point man breathing heavily when he's close to dying. It's a cool way of telling the player to use a medkit, and as far as I know, it's the only time we ever hear the point man make any real noise in the game. I'd also like to mention that there actually is a new, slightly different replica variant called a desert replica in this area as well, but they're so similar looking to the recon replicas, I didn't even notice they were any different until this playthrough. Still, it's a nice little bit of world building that indicates Armacam was planning to or may already have sold replica soldiers for operations in countries with desert climates. Speaking of Armacam, I couldn't help but notice this peculiar cup sitting on the table here. I know it's probably just the developers reusing assets, but it's funny to imagine that a replica brought his standard issue coffee mug over from wherever he was stationed previously and just set it down on the table before he started his patrol. A little known secret about this area is that there is actually a third replica variant
variant that can be unlocked known as the floating head replicas. Actually, no, this is just a weird bug I...
Shut up!
As I was saying, this is actually just a weird bug I got when I was using ghost mode commands to get footage, and it turned everyone in the surrounding area invisible instead of just the point man. Anyway, as you can probably already tell, like everything else in this game, I could talk about the church offices for hours, but I've been working on this video for over 9 months now, and I'm about ready to wrap it up. All I can say is that this area is one of the finest examples of FPS combat I've ever had the pleasure of playing through, and if somebody stuck me on an island and told me I could choose only one video game level to entertain myself with for the rest of my days, I'd pick this one. So once we finish off the replicas in the offices, the first interval is basically over. We get one last visit from Fettel and another from our dear old mom. And after that, we have finally made it out of the church and beaten the first level. Okay, so let's recap. Approximately 1 day ago, a massive explosion at a secret Armacam containment facility released a powerful psychic named Alma Wade into the Auburn district of the city of Fairport. The vengeful Alma resurrected her recently deceased son, Paxton Fettel, and his replica army along with him, who then laid waste to the city since their original goal of freeing Alma had already been achieved. Any citizens who were not able to leave the area in time have either been killed or are in hiding, desperately waiting for any opportunity to escape. With the replicas having disabled all communication to the outside world, the city is completely isolated, and it's unclear if the national government is simply unaware of the situation or if they are still trying to formulate some plan of attack. In addition, the Fairport airspace is completely dominated by replica-piloted Mi-24 gunships, and all major entrances to the city are under siege, making any type of evacuation exceptionally difficult. Delta Force operators are scattered throughout the district as well, doing their best to help any surviving citizens and regroup with one another, likely so they can coordinate some type of rescue effort. Now, just a few minutes ago, a massive fucking hell portal has opened up and is raining down demons from the Almaverse into the city. And in the middle of it all is a special government combat operative who at this point would probably trade his left testicle for a few hours sleep. But since this is only the first level, there's still plenty of game left, and while I'm not sure if the point man and his buddies are gonna make it out of this alive, I do know one thing for certain. It's going to be a very long night.